Well. Here we are. Question for you. Do you know who you're voting for? Because from what I'm hearing on the streets, a lot of people are torn and a lot of people are confused. But before we get to that, hey, it's your boy BG. Welcome to the BG Show. Can you do something for me right now? Meaning subscribing to this channel, tapping that notification bell, and make sure to follow us across all of our social media. So listen, I get it. The reality is every one of these parties and their leaders, they carry some baggage. There are some things you might like, some things you might dislike. And you know what? Some people might have been turned off from the entire process. But a lot of people are also voting for many different reasons. Some of them can actually be personal. But here's the thing. On this episode, I wanted to give you BG's take on the leaders, give you some analysis on what has transpired during this election, but also hear from you. So we actually hit the streets to hear what you had to say about all the different leaders. First up, Justin Trudeau and the Liberals. To just get your gut reaction on some of the leaders, what do you think about Justin Trudeau as a leader?
Well, he actually threatened us, saying anyone unvaxxed is basically going to lose their rights. So, and I've heard people are throwing rocks at him. I've heard of him touring around and everyone's pissed, saying, "F you, you're a No one likes you." Like, I don't know. So it's just a lot. Trudeau's got to go.
Ooh!
That's a bar. Is this what all this is about?
That's a bar.
No, okay. Everyone's saying that. It's not just me.
Why are you a Liberal supporter? I guess would be our question.
I love Justin Trudeau.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What about him?
I love Justin Trudeau. I've been following since his father's days. And I just love what they're doing and what they stand for, the Liberals.
Like,
So how do you feel about Justin Trudeau as a leader?
So far, not so good, you know what I mean?
Like, you're on
I'm
the
not
fence
knocking
about him.
I am very on the fence about him.
What about him in particular?
He is a good leader, but he is he's royalty. His father was prime minister.
It's a nepotism for you.
Correct.
Trudeau, how do you feel about him as a leader?
I think there's a lot of surfaceness to Trudeau, and people see through him in terms of his feminism, for example. He needs to do some deeper work.
All right, those were some interesting perspectives. But you know, for Justin Trudeau and in this election, the big thing that he needed to answer was, why did he call this election? And the reason that he gave Canadians didn't really satisfy a lot of people.
After making it through 17 months of nothing like we've ever experienced, Canadians deserve to choose what the next 17 months, what the next 17 years and beyond will look like.
So what did that do? Well, it kind of forced Trudeau and the Liberals to run on their record. And listen, they've been in power for the last 6 years, so that can be really, really tricky. Now, I'm not saying that they didn't accomplish anything. No, they did. I mean, let's go through it a little bit. They did legalize weed, right? They started the road to reconciliation with Indigenous people. They also started the process of implementing the massively popular $10 a day childcare plan. But they haven't finished all of those promises. And because of that, that does linger and stay on a lot of people's minds. And we also have to remember this. A lot of people have been feeling anxious, upset, angry at the time that we're living in with this pandemic. COVID-19 came out of nowhere and it turned people's lives upside down, took away some people's privileges, their ability to live. So they were mad about that and they wanted to take it out on someone. And here we are in an election where you vote for the next leader. Likely people are gonna do that. Now, we invited Trudeau onto our show. We held a one-on-one conversation with him. I spoke with him and I asked him about vaccination policies, which is a trigger word for a lot of people in this country because it's personal. His response, well, lacked a bit of empathy. Here's the receipts. I think about maybe people of color who have a historical concern. Historically, they've been used as guinea pigs. I'm talking Black people, I'm talking even Indigenous people. There is legit concern about there that people might just need a bit more empathy, a bit more information, and it seems like their livelihoods are at risk if they choose not to make this choice.
Do you know what puts livelihoods at risk? COVID. Do you know what put livelihoods at risk? More lockdowns, more shutdowns.
I wish we had some more time to go in a bit on those vaccine passports and some of that stuff.
But I know you guys the way through this pandemic is to choose to get vaccinated. And if you make the choice not to, you're putting other people at risk.
I know, but it's the empathy for people who are struggling with the decision.
Huge amounts of empathy. I want to keep them out of emergency room beds as well.
So, I mean, with a response like that, it's not really going to convince people who have been upset with you to kind of make amends. Now, here's the thing, the difficult thing for a lot of people is that when you look at the Liberal platform, there are many things in there that will help a lot of people. Childcare, that childcare plan, again, like I mentioned, very popular. The help for students, for example, the targeting of programs for the Black community, also some important things. But for many people, the real question is, can you separate the man from the platform? That's gonna be the big thing for the Liberals. We'll have to see how that plays out. All right. Now let's talk about the Conservatives. Yeah. How do you feel about Erin O'Toole?
Don't ask.
Actually, let me reverse myself then. Not a fan.
Absolutely not.
Is there something about him or is it his policies?
No, it's the Conservative policies. I think he's trying to be a little bit more progressive than some of his, you know, counterparts, but no, Conservatives are not progressive. I'd never vote Conservative.
How do you feel about Erin O'Toole as a leader?
I really don't know much about him, and as I said, I'm not like too into politics, but yeah. I know he kind of wants the same thing, to enforce the vaccine passports and...
Well, he actually believes in choice, he says.
Oh, well, I don't know too much. I don't watch mainstream media, so I don't really have too much information. I'm not too intelligent, but yeah. I do have, like you said, the gut feeling of saying, something is wrong in this country.
Erin O'Toole, he's a conservative. I think he has Alberta's interests more than Ontario. That's a constant conservative leadership issue, right?
How do you feel about the messaging from the Conservatives?
Well, I don't like the Conservatives. Never have, never will.
You see, this was a very interesting election for the Conservatives because they came into it with most people not knowing who the heck Erin O'Toole was. Right? And listen, that can be a good or it can be a bad thing. Initially though, it was a good thing because he said a lot of the right things, things that we didn't necessarily hear from previous conservative leaders, like addressing climate change, for example. That's actually in the conservative platform. Reconciliation with Indigenous people, we heard Erin O'Toole talk about that. We also heard O'Toole talk about support for the LGBT community. When was the last time you heard a conservative leader say something about that? Right? But then the campaign went on and then slip-ups began when he started talking about policy. We saw that when it came to guns and assault rifles and the ban that the Liberals put in place. Well, O'Toole said first he wouldn't replace that ban, then he kind of got a little wishy-washy on that. And then people looked into his platform a little bit more, and then they found out that he wanted to not implement the $10 a day childcare plan, which again is very popular. In his platform, there was also no mention of systemic racism or Black people or even Islamophobia, all things which do need to be addressed. So it kind of made people feel like this guy that you didn't necessarily even know, the question that came up in many people's minds was, can you trust this guy? So I want to be very honest and transparent with you guys. We actually invited Erin O'Toole on the show to have a one-on-one. His team denied. Their fault. Their fault. They didn't want to be on the show. That's their fault. But the big thing with O'Toole is that he had the potential to kind of sweep this campaign. But the reality is, which many people probably can agree with, is that he came across a little bland. There was no big policy, no big promise to inspire people to vote for him. So the big question is, will people actually vote for him? Do they have something to vote for? We'll have to see come election day. All right, now let's talk about the NDP and Jagmeet Singh. How do you feel about Jagmeet Singh?
Believe it or not, I like Jagmeet Singh.
Okay.
I think his policies are grand.
What about him though?
Him as a person, I think he's good. I think he'd be a great leader. I honestly think he'd be a great leader. And I know it's going to sound, history repeats itself, but if you remember back when Jack Layton was alive, Jack Layton, he swayed the vote either way, right? Mm. Because it was a three-party system, truly. Let's face it, the Liberals called this election so that they can get a majority, so that they can pass whatever rules and regulations they want forth with this pandemic. I do believe, though, that if Jagmeet Singh comes into power and gets a majority of seats for the new Democratic Party, I believe that his sway on the vote on either side would be good.
Do you think Jagmeet Singh has a chance to win this election?
I think Jagmeet Singh has a chance to really influence what happens in Parliament, and that's important.
Okay.
I think we need a strong NDP push to move the government in a certain area, a certain way.
What about Jagmeet Singh and the NDP?
I like him too.
Okay.
But I still Liberal.
Jagmeet, again, same with Trudeau. It's all about looking nice, appearing nice, as long as the cameras are on.
So what's preventing you from voting NDP?
What's preventing me?
Yeah.
Not really nothing, but the fact, simple fact that I love Trudeau.
So you you think Jagmeet Singh is authentic?
Is that safe to say? Yes, I actually do. Okay. I honestly do. And I believe that, I believe that that's part of the mosaic of Canada. Mm. You know what I mean?
Everybody loves Jagmeet Singh. Come on. It's undeniable. He's very popular with a lot of people, especially young people. Have you checked the man's TikTok?
Nope. Yep.
Killing it. And you know what? Jagmeet does an amazing job with connecting with people. That's really where he shines. But here's the difficulty with the NDP every single election, and that's trying to get people to believe they can actually win, right? One of the big problems for the NDP that happens every election is that the Liberals always like to eat their cake. What do I mean by that? Let me explain. So you look at the political spectrum, right? On the right, you have parties like the PPC and the Conservatives. On the left, you got the NDP and the Liberals. But what we've seen in the last couple of elections is that the Liberals will kind of take these big policy, you know, things that were always associated with the NDP, like affordable childcare and erasing interest on student debt, and the Liberals would adopt that in their platform. So it kind of makes it hard to figure out, well, what is the difference between the two parties? Jagmeet Singh will like to say, obviously, that you can trust him more than you can trust Justin Trudeau. And maybe that might be true, but is that enough to convince people to vote for you? So the question is, how do you differentiate yourself? And in this election, the big topic on everybody's mind was the pandemic, vaccination policies. And I asked Jagmeet, what was his stance on that? Well, here's what he had to say. The mandatory vaccination policy for even federal workers, for example, those that are hesitant, do you not think that people who are hesitant should still have a bit more time rather than having to choose between the two?
Well, they can certainly get the answers that they have questions to. They can find that out. They can speak with their healthcare providers. And for folks who've got a specific healthcare exemption, that's different. There's some people that are dealing with healthcare problems that mean that they can get vaccinated. But for everyone else, if there's not a bona fide reason, they should be getting vaccinated. And if they choose not to, then, you know, there's going to be some jobs that they're not going to be able to do.
Now, I'm not saying his stance is incorrect or correct. I'm just saying when it sounds like what the other major party leaders are saying, it's hard for voters then to differentiate or decide, this is why I'm going to vote for you. He still might get a lot of votes, but will he get enough to win? Will he convince Canadians that the NDP actually has a chance? We'll have to see. All right. Let's talk about the PPC and the Green Party. Anime Paul?
I like Anime Paul. Believe it or not, I'm an environmental technician.
Okay.
Right. I'm a field technician for EnviroSystems.
And do you like her as a leader, as a person?
I do like her as a leader, and I do like her as a person. I do like her policies.
What about her?
I believe that she's selling the environment hard, and in the sense that, okay, like on a multinational conglomerate scale, environmentalism sells, but nobody's buying unless there's profit in it. You know what I mean? And she would take that profiteering out of that aspect of it. You know?
You think she's extremely intelligent, it sounds.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, man. You know, and I think she's a great leader.
Maxime Bernier, though, you like him?
I don't know if I like him or not, but a lot of people are just kind of swaying me into this choice. So.
Got it. All right. Well, thanks so
much
for your time.
I just don't like Justin Trudeau. That's all I know.
Well, you said what you said, and you mean what you mean. How do you feel about Anime?
Honestly, I think it's the lack of exposure in the media. I don't know anything about her because, again, the media is not reporting on anybody outside of the big three.
I'm just providing analysis on how I think this election campaign has gone. I'm not saying I support anybody, any particular person. I'm just saying this is how I feel the election campaign played out. It's been very surprising. The amount of people that have said they want to potentially vote for the PPC and Maxime Bernier in this election. And I think a lot of it has to do with that wedge issue, okay? Let me say that correctly, wedge issue, which is about vaccinations, right? A lot of people are either for or against, and people, for many people, it's personal. And they will block out everything else except for that issue. And the PPC has put themselves in a position where they're standing here and everybody else is standing over here. And that's why we've seen a drastic increase in support. We've heard it on the streets ourselves. But when you actually look into the PPC's platform, I mean, it's actually kind of missing a few things, like identifying the fact that climate change is even real. That's a big thing. Now over to the Green Party. The challenge for Annamie Paul in this election was to highlight and showcase that she in fact can keep the party together. Here's the thing, massive history, her story maybe we should say, the first Black woman to lead a federal party. But going into this election, I mean, the headlines were crucifying for her. There were some headlines even saying that some Green candidates didn't want her to campaign with them for fear that she would make them lose. We did speak with Annamie Paul, and we gotta say, I mean, the woman who we met and interviewed, so different from the perception and narrative that was set in mainstream media. Just take a listen. Mm-hmm.
What is the Green Party presenting to voters?
Yeah, well, first, I hope that the fundamentals are the same. Mm-hmm. You know, we have core values that attracted me to the party. So respect for diversity, ecological wisdom, nonviolence. Those things, whether it's me or Elizabeth or the next person, will always be there. People can count on that. What are some of the things that are different? I mean, I'm different, right? I'm from a different part of the country. Yeah. I'm from a different generation. My parents come from the Caribbean, a family of things like essential workers, frontline workers. My mom was a teacher. You know, you bring all of your experience to politics. Every person is different. And so I bring all of that with me, all of those things that I mentioned and more, you know, my education, my professional experience. And so as I approach these issues, I offer a new perspective. And so people can expect me to be talking about the climate and the environment as always. They can also expect me to be talking about how we can ensure everyone lives a life of dignity, how we're going to dismantle systemic racism, how we're going to achieve reconciliation. Those are all green things, but I think that having me in this role helps to focus people a little bit more on those and to associate our party with them a little bit more.
In fact, what we also witnessed during this campaign is that Annamie on the debate stage was more than capable of holding her own. She not only showed off her intelligence, but she showed that she definitely is a capable leader.
I actually had to pull my jaw up, which just dropped, when I heard what Mr. Blanchette said. I invited Mr. Blanchette to get educated about systemic discrimination. I extend that invitation again. I would be happy to educate him.
It's nice to want to educate
me. This is my time, sir. It is.
Thank you. So nice time to insult people.
That was not an insult. It was an invitation to educate yourself.
The real question, though, is, will people still vote green after all of that turmoil that we witnessed in the beginning? The other thing that we also know is that Annamie Paul is up against a very popular liberal candidate in Toronto Centre, which is Marcy Ian. So who are people gonna vote for? That's a big question. This entire campaign has been a big question mark. Is that not true? So how are you feeling right now? We want to know in the comment section. What I do want to say, though, if I can say something definitively, is that don't waste your right to vote. There are many people in countries out there who do not have the democratic freedom that we have. And I know some people might not like all the leaders or their platforms of what they've been promising, but try to find something, because the worst thing you could ever do is waste your vote. In the meantime, keep it locked on the BG Show for all of the results and for what happens next after the election. We're going to continue covering it. And we'll give you all the news you can use and all the entertainment you can use. And now I need a glass of water. So thank you for tuning in. Don't forget to subscribe to this channel, tap that notification bell, and follow us across all of our social media. BG out, and happy Election Day.